Hello, everybody! I hope you guys are doing great this Sunday, the fourth Sunday of Advent. Can someone just let me know if you guys can hear me okay? Let me take these off. Don't need these anymore. It's been a while since I streamed, so hopefully all the settings are still working okay. Always worry about that because they do these auto updates. And so, you know, they change things. I had to actually re-download some of the software for my mic. So, in any case, hopefully you guys can see me, hear me, everything works. Someone in chat, let me know. Okay. But it's good to be back. It's good to be back streaming again. I'm on break. Most of you probably know I'm a teacher. You know, I'm an adult. I'm a sophisticated person. I teach math. And now my students are on break, which means I'm on a break, which is pretty nice. That's one of the nice things about being a teacher is your breaks are the same breaks as the breaks that students have. So I'm basically just like, you know, a student. I get like a Christmas break off. I get summers off. That's pretty nice. So it's great to see Requiem. I don't know who Wignat Nation is. Hopefully not Wignat. I hope that's in jest. I hope that's a joke. It's good to see Baseburger, all of you guys. So let me just, before we get into talking about whatever you guys want to talk about, I do have a little bit of Christology. I want to talk a little bit about Christology prepared. A little Christmas message on top of that. Before we get into any of that, I just wanted to say that if you're interested in patronizing me, like monetarily, not like looking down on me, not that kind of patronizing, but if you're willing to be a Patreon, I have some links here for you guys, and it actually does really help me. And thank you to those people who are my Patreons, patrons, because it does really help me. Because, and let me just put the link there. Hopefully that worked. Okay, and it really does help me. Because I'm only a part-time teacher. I only teach part-time. It feels like a full-time job because it's the first year as a teacher, but I don't make a lot of money. And so on the side, I actually substitute teach. On the side, I do a little bit of substituting at public schools, private schools, etc. throughout the area I live. And for that reason, if you guys support the show, if you like the content of the show by supporting me monetarily, it puts less pressure on me to have to find on my days off substitute like positions, and I can spend more time making content. So there's a positive and direct relationship between supporting the channel monetarily and the content, and more content I'm able to produce. Please support me through Patreon. I prefer that over Entropy, though. Let me put the Entropy link as well. You can ask questions through Entropy, obviously. The Entropy, the thing about them is they only let you actually get money if you make like a certain amount, and I haven't made that amount obviously since I haven't been streaming a lot. So, but Patreon is nice because it's like a continued thing. Anyway, I don't like having to ask people for money. It's not really in my nature, but I have to put that out there. I've been watching other channels to create response videos. Probably noticed I've been doing a lot of response videos. I have so many ideas of like videos I want to do. Dr. Ortland did one on purgatory. I want to do a little bit of response to that. I saw Jimmy Akin and Dr. Ortland talked about Sola Scriptura. There's so much I just want to get into, but I just don't have a lot of time. But so hopefully now that I'm off on break, I can get a little into that and make a little more content for you guys, God willingly, but we'll see what happens. So, in any case, those are the links there for you. I hope you guys are doing well on this Sunday. Hopefully you're able to go to Mass as we prepare ourselves for the coming of the Nativity of Christ the King. That's what Christmas comes from, is it's Christ Mass. It's the Nativity of Christ. Most people know this. And then, of course, Mass comes from the end of the Latin Mass. Ite Missa Est. It is finished. That's where the word Mass comes from. It's Christ Mass. Christmas. So Christmas is a very distinctly, extremely distinctly Catholic holiday, though it has become very much just a secular cultural phenomenon. We should work to kind of take it back, redeem it. But that's not what I'm here to talk about, the war on Christmas or anything like that, or its cultural ramifications or anything to that extent. I want to talk about Christ. I want to talk about Christology, and both in more of a broad sense as well as an intellectual sense. I want my followers to have a rich and deep understanding of who the nature of Christ is, lest they like fall into heresy, and so that they remain in orthodoxy, but for that one thing, but for another reason, just because it gives us a greater appreciation for the faith, it gives us a greater love and admiration for Christ, and helps us understand the mystery of the incarnation at a deeper level. And when we see that this is logical and reasonable, and there's a method to what the church has taught, and this isn't just like some paradox, that Christ is all God and all man, then it allows us to, I think, fall in love with Christ in a very special way. At least for me, as someone who's very excited about the intellectual aspect or the intellectual side of Christianity. But before I get into that, and I have a whole whiteboard here to talk about different ideas, before we get into that, and like I always say, at the end of my little monologue, we can have a more casual conversation. I'll try to keep up with the chat. Until then, I probably will miss what you're saying, so you can put your questions through Entropy or what have you. Otherwise, just wait till the end. What I was thinking about, I was reflecting on Christ coming into the world and how he begins his journey outside his mother's womb. Obviously, Mary, the Virgin Mother, is like the Ark of the Covenant. She's preserved, and we just recently celebrated the Immaculate Conception, the Feast of the Immaculate Conception. She's preserved since her birth from original sin. This is very much connected with monergism in the Augustinian tradition. That Mary was specially destined for this. She was preserved. Like most of us, when we're born, we basically just fall into mud, which is original sin, but as Duns Scotus says, that Mary was kept from that. God kept her from falling into mud and preserved her throughout her entire life. She was full of grace, past, present, and future, when the angel Gabriel said that to her. And so when Jesus is born, he's placed in a manger. And most people know the Christmas story. There's no room in the inn. They're in Bethlehem because Caesar Augustus is performing a census. And there's no room in the inn, so they have to go to a stable. Jesus is born, and he's placed into a manger. What is a manger? It's like this, like a trough almost, where they have hay and wheat, I believe. And this is where like animals eat from. So it's not a very clean place. And yet this is where Jesus made his throne. This became his throne room because, of course, Christ is king. He is the rightful king in virtue of his birth, in virtue of his work on the cross. And so this became his throne in a sense. And people often, I think, the most immediate conclusion is that this shows that Christ's humility, that Christ is humble. He's a humble king. Or perhaps it tells us that we should have no attachment to material possession, since Christ did not. Christ was not interested in a material kingship at the moment. He was interested in a spiritual kingship. Later on, he will establish a temporal and material reign. And so we shouldn't be attached to material possession. We shouldn't be filled with avarice or something like that. And that's obviously all true, but what really got my gears turning was the fact that our souls, that Christ comes into this dark world, as the book of John says, that the Word was made flesh, he came into this dark world, and the darkness did not comprehend it. And we always say this at the end of the Latin Mass, this summation of the Gospel from John at the beginning of the first chapter. And I was thinking about it, and he comes into this straw, very dirty bed, and that's almost like our souls, where our souls are... I think we can all agree, you know, they're not very clean places. We've fallen into sin. We've fallen, most of us, into mortal sin. Even after our baptism, we've fallen into mortal sin, perhaps even habitual mortal sin. And these are things that we struggle with throughout our entire lives because of, you know, the fall. And yet Christ comes into this place, he sits himself, and then he becomes the king of that place. He takes it on as his throne. This is now his throne, despite the unclean environment. And so I was just thinking about that. I remembered the Eucharist, in which when we receive, because everything in the Christian faith points us towards the Eucharist. All the other six sacraments, they have arrows, as St. Thomas says, that point us to the Eucharist. And so even Christ coming into the manger, it's like when we received Holy Communion. And now I should be very careful and say, don't receive Holy Communion outside of a state of grace. Don't receive a mortal sin. Obviously, at that point, you're dead. It's not just that your soul is made of straw. It doesn't exist. It's dead. You are spiritually dead. Now, when we are in a state of grace, we still have venial sin or distractions or proclivities. And this is why we still need to perform penance, and we still need to fast, and we still need to pray and all these other things to keep from falling back into mortal sin. And so our souls are still, you know, straw in a sense. Our souls are still in this place of poverty, spiritually speaking. And yet Christ comes down into us. And that's why I love when we receive Holy Communion on the tongue kneeling, because it's this very apt sign. It's very symbolic that Christ is the one that's coming down to us to feed us, and that we are merely receiving Christ. In the same way that the manger is just receiving Christ, Mary just placed him on the manger. The manger didn't do anything because it couldn't. Simply a manger. And our souls, we are lost without Christ. Christ has to come to us and feed our souls. He comes down to us and becomes the incarnate God. And then he becomes and establishes a kingdom in our hearts. He establishes a kingdom in our hearts. It becomes for him the throne room. And this is the beginning of our journey to theosis. And then later in the final resurrection, we are able to receive a glorified body because we're able to share in that divine life. And so that was just something I was reflecting on. And so I hope you guys found that interesting. But I want to transition real quickly to talking about now who is Christ. Because, you know, I was talking about this to my students. I asked them, like, who is Jesus? And they said, oh, he's God. And then I asked them, okay, so was heaven empty then when Jesus was on earth? Did God transmorgify into Jesus? They said, well, no, there's a Trinity and there's God in heaven and God on earth. And I said, okay, so God came to earth and is like, so is Jesus then like an apparition? Is it just look like he's a man? And they said, well, no, he is a man. And I was like, okay, so I'm a man, but I'm not God. So what makes Jesus God? And so these questions I began to ask them, got my students thinking about these things. And the early church began to think about these things long before any of us did. And there was a lot of debate and discussion that led to various heresies and different errors that began to spread out in the early church. And so I want to go through and walk through who Christ is, just question by question, point by point, pointing out where the errors are. And I think it's really important because some of you might think, oh, this is just very intellectual, or this isn't really something that's valuable to me as a lay person. Maybe for a theologian or a pastor or a priest or something like that, this could be valuable. But I want to challenge you to say that no, because people often neglect these areas. There is room for heterodoxy and even heresy that you see in other Christian denominations amongst educated people. And so if the lay people can be educated on this, then we can avoid, and they can avoid, people, for example, like William Lane Craig or Wayne Grudem. These are Protestants, of course. You should avoid them for that reason. But there's certain heresies that they've fallen into that were condemned by the early church. And I'll go into that in a minute here. So hopefully you guys can read this. What's a good place to put this here? All right, so the first question that the church was concerned about was, is Christ human or is he divine? And so there were some people called the Ebionites. They said that Christ was just human. He was simply human, but he was like Superman or something like that. Let's see, did the lighting change? Is the lighting okay? I feel like the lighting, I think I'm reflecting light from the whiteboard, and that's why it's looking weird. All right, in any case, sorry about the weird lighting, though. So basically, Christ was just like Superman. He was a man, but he had maybe some special powers or something like that. Condemned as a heresy, obviously. The second notion was that Christ was fully divine. He was not human. He was like a ghost or an apparition walking on earth. And this, of course, deprives from Christ all his human attributes that we read in the Bible. When it says that, like, Christ is tempted, or when Christ weeps, things like this. He has very much human emotions and a human nature. And this is called asceticism, again, a heresy that strips Christ of the human element, which is very much necessary, that human element, in order to redeem other humans. He has to become human so that he can take on the liability of us humans on the cross. All right, and then of course the true understanding is that Christ is both human and divine. And then the next question was about how is Christ divine? How is we understand that Christ is the second person of the Trinity and the Word made incarnate. But how is he divine? How does he share in the divine essence? And this is a question that goes to, I guess you could say, like the Trinity. And the first belief that you see appearing in the early church was that Christ is different. He differs from God the Father, that Christ is begotten in time. This is the first belief and was proposed by Arius. He says that Christ is begotten in time, or he's not co-eternal with the Father, and he's also subordinate to the Father. So he's begotten in time and he's subordinate to the Father. He's different from God the Father. Though he is divine, he's different. He doesn't share in the divine essence equally with God the Father. And this is, of course, a heresy that was condemned at the First Nicene Council, Arianism. Unfortunately, it really did take over the church for quite a long time. And this actually kind of dovetails into some things that are happening today with what Pope Francis just recently did. I don't know if you guys saw this, but Pope Francis basically, or he approved, rather, Pope Francis approved a document from the Congregation of the Doctrine of Faith, which was clarifying some of the liturgical changes that his motu proprio, His Holiness's motu proprio, Traditionis Custodis, put forth about restricting the Lion Mass. And in this, these changes, or this clarification, as they call it, they restricted the sacraments, the other sacraments in the traditional form. So I believe it's going to be much more harder, much more difficult to be baptized, receive reconciliation or matrimony in the traditional form, because it couldn't be done in a parish church. And then it's almost altogether, I think, banned confirmations and ordinations in the traditional form or something like that. So there's really a lot of restrictions. And so a lot of, I think, traditional Catholics or conservative Catholics are very worried about this. And we have to remind ourselves that in history, there was this time in the church when Arianism, this clear, distinct heresy, really took over almost all the church, almost all the Eastern patriarchs. It had a strong foothold on them. And so if the Eastern Orthodox ever tried to call us heretics or anything like that because of like Pope Francis's modernist proclivities, you should always point them back to the early church, in which every single patriarch in the East had fallen into some kind of heresy in the beginning of the church. It was only the Pope at the very beginning of the church, or the Patriarch of the West, or the Bishop of Rome, who hadn't fallen into these explicit heresies like Arianism. That being said, I think it was Pope Liberius. He was under pressure from the Arians, and so this was not, you know, an act of his own will, but it was something that was kind of forced on him by the Arians to produce this semi-Arians document that got St. Athanasius excommunicated. St. Athanasius, he was one of the good bishops in this very dark time in the church. They called him St. Athanasius Contra Mundi, St. Athanasius against the world, because he's one of the few bishops standing up against all these changes. And what's interesting, as I think about St. Athanasius, is it's obviously a clear parallel to Marcel Lefebvre, that he didn't create some new parallel church. He wasn't, instead of a contest or anything like that, he maintained the church. But even thinking about like the arguments that Martin Luther was making, I've been trying to get more into some of the classical Protestant arguments, some of the more high church stuff from Lutherans. And Luther argued that the Rome had lost her way. She had fallen into heresy and gone against the Bible. I don't believe that. Now, but let's say that is the case. Well, the precedent of history is not to create your own church, to not just like create your own church with your new ecclesiology and new ecclesiastical structures and your own new dogmas, but it's to wait till the church reforms herself. And eventually she will, because we trust in God's promise to her, spoken to Peter when Christ said, "The gates of hell will not prevail against you," against the church. The church is indefectible. God will redeem the church, of course. And I imagine, and I pray, that what happens in our lifetime. And I imagine that will, given the nature of the current generation, and the fact that it's really only like boomers who hate the Latin Mass because it represents this threat to all the work they did in Vatican II. It seems like anyone else does not care. They're either ambivalent to the Latin Mass or they're in support of it. So I imagine it won't be long before, you know, there will see a real restoration of the Roman Rite. Going back to now what I was saying, it's good to see you guys. No, it's not Aryanism as in like Nazi Aryan or Indo-Aryan or the Yamuna tribe or anything like that. No, that's not what we mean by Aryan. We're talking about Arius. It's spelled differently too. Okay. And then there's another semi-Aryan heresy that in which we say that Christ is similar to God the Father. They say that he is co-eternal with God the Father. He shares equally, even maybe in the divine essence, but he's not quite the same because he is still subordinate to God the Father in eternity. Some of the Protestants, the new Calvinists, make this distinction. They say, well, there's the economic Trinity, which is how God relates to us, and then there's the ontological Trinity, how God is. And in the economic Trinity, God is eternally subordinate to, or Jesus is rather, is eternally subordinate to the Father, but in the ontological Trinity, they're equal, or something like that. That still qualifies for the semi-Aryan position of subordination. And this is a heresy. This is a heresy that's being taught in systematic theologies that exist on my father's bookshelf. My father is, you know, very reformed. He has these systematic theologies. You read them, they advocate for that position. And so you can see that ignorance of the early church leads to this revitalization of all these ancient heresies that we see. No, as Karl Rahner, who's a very modernist theologian, but he's right here. He says that the immanent Trinity is the ontological Trinity and vice versa. And the economic Trinity is the ontological Trinity, often sometimes called the immanent Trinity, and vice versa. Because the way who God is how he's going to reveal himself to us. That's how we can trust that God's word is correct, because the way God reveals himself to us, for example, in Christ, is who God is. For example, Christ's work on the cross, it reveals that God is just, and that he's also merciful, and he's also loving. In his promises, for example, God's promises to Abraham, it shows that the nature of God, he is someone who he remains faithful to the promises he makes to his people, things like this. And so we see that heresy, you know, even today coming up. And then, of course, the correct view is that they share equally in the divine essence, that Jesus is the same as God the Father. I just put God F, that means God the Father there. Hopefully you guys can read this okay. I know with my students, they like, you know, these visual kind of representations, and makes it easier to follow along. And so that was the second question they answered. So the first question was, is Jesus human, divine, or both? They said, okay, he's both human and divine. He has a human and divine nature, and his divine nature is equal to the divine nature of God the Father. The next question was his association with the two natures. How do the two natures, persons, we haven't gotten to natures yet. How did the human person or the divine person interact, or how are they associated? And the first theory was hypostasis. And hypostasis, basically, and this is Nestorianism, you might have heard of the Nestorian heresy in history, it basically said that they're distinct persons, that there's the person of Jesus Christ, and then there's the second person of the Trinity, the Logos, in heaven. There's like two persons, and there's like some concomitants, so that they're moving together or thinking together or something like that, and that's condemned. That was a condemned heresy, and rather the view is, it's called the hypostatic view. The hypostatic view says that there's one person, Jesus Christ, second person of the Trinity. Well, they became one person, they're one person only, and he has two natures. The two natures are the human nature and the divine nature, as divine nature is equal to the divine nature of God the Father. And when he came onto earth, there's something also called kenosis. Christ emptied himself of some of, for example, his divine attributes, based on the Bible. It seems that God, and even writings that I believe it's Hebrews, says that Christ emptied himself, or the word in Greek is kenosis. And so we don't see off sometimes Christ having perfectly, you know, all the divine attributes all at once. But regardless, those two natures do exist in the person of Christ. Okay. So that covers that whiteboard there. And then continuing, the next question that the early church was posed with was, how does the human and divine natures interact? What is the physics, the physical interaction? How do they How do they associate with each other? And again, there was various theories that were produced. The first was that they were combined together. The human and divine nature were combined into one nature. And there's different methods for this. The first method was it was dissolved. The divine nature was dissolved. The human nature was dissolved into the divine nature in the same way that Mentos dissolves in Diet Coke, or if you drop salt into water, it dissolves, or something like that. The human nature was like this grain of salt that you drop into water and it dissolves eventually. The second method was called Apollinarianism. Is basically this idea that Jesus is a human with a divine mind. And so it's basically like me, I'm a person, and I have a mind, in a material mind. And so Jesus, he's a human, he has a human brain perhaps, but his mind is a material mind, is just a divine mind, it's God's mind. And that's the view that William Lane Craig, which probably is the most popular apologist in Christianity, one of the most popular apologists in Christianity, does lots of debates. He believes in Neo-Apollinarianism, and this is a condemned heresy. He believes that Jesus had the mind of God, but a human body. And that's not true. There's only one person, and Christ, and the reason why this is condemned is because it takes away from Christ's humanity. I am human, and as a human, I have an immaterial mind, and it's a human immaterial mind. In the same way, Christ, if he is to be fully human, have a fully human nature, then he also has to have a fully human mind as well, and a divine mind. He has both. And we see this in the scriptures when, for example, he says when he's tempted or things like this of this sort, we can see in the wilderness, we can see the human mind interacting with the divine mind. All right. And then there's a final method, which is without alteration. I just put without alt, and it just means without alteration, the two, human nature and the divine nature interact, and without alteration either. I don't really understand how that would work if they're combined, but in any case, that's not the view that the church went with. The view the church went with was that they're distinct. There's distinct human nature and distinct, divine nature. They're separate, but they they're fully there, but they're two separate things. And then the last question that the church had to reckon with was intent, or the will of Jesus. Did Jesus have one will, which is monothelitism, or did he have two wills, which is diothelitism? And so monothelites was actually a really popular heresy for a long time. And even one of the popes, Pope Honorius I, he was accused of being a monothelite. He said that Christ had only one will, in the same way that Adam had only one will, and that's not true. Christ has two wills, because, again, he has a mind that's divine and a mind that's human. And so he has the divine will and a human will, and that's why he can be tempted, because his human will could be subject to temptation, but of course his divine will is supreme and it is in control. It is superior to it. And that's why, I believe it's the third council or fourth council of Constantinople, he was condemned, Pope Honorius. He was anathematized by Leo the Third, I believe, as well. So, if there was ever a pope, that committed heresy prior to, the post-Vatican II popes, it would definitely be someone like Honorius. And then, of course, the correct view is diothelitism. Christ has two wills. And this was the position that was championed and made the Orthodox, and by Orthodox I mean lowercase o, right belief. It's the true position of the church at the Council of Chalcedon, the hypostatic union. It was all confirmed there at Chalcedon. And anyone who claims to be Christian must adopt these things. This is one of the first seven ecumenical councils. Doesn't matter if you're Protestant, Catholic, Eastern Orthodox, Oriental Orthodox. You all have to accept these. They're basic tenets of Christianity. And this is one of the reasons why Mormons are not Christians, because they don't believe that. Oh my goodness. Among other things like baptism and the nature of God, they also disagree with that. Which is why, it's... I hope to have a discussion in one of these days with Kyclips. I reached out to him over DMs and Twitter. He said eventually you might be interested. Man, I got some dust in my throat. Wow. And the reason why I want to have that discussion with him is because there are some serious differences, and I think in his, like, he had a debate with some, like, liberal Christian, and he kind of, like, I think wanted to make it seem like, oh no, Mormons, we're just Christians too, we just do, like, quirky things, we, like, drink water instead of grape juice or wine at communion, and we baptize the dead, we just do a little quirky, and we have a few extra, we have an extra book written by Joseph Smith. And so there's a lot more to it, and this is why they're not considered Christian by any I guess orthodox or traditional understanding of a Christian. But again, I want to have a charitable discussion. I want to understand where he's coming from. So I want to be, you know, like a debate. I would just want to ask him questions, clarify things, because I'm not an expert in Mormonism, and so that would be my intent. So. Anyway, I think he did get kind of owned, and when, especially when it comes to the nature of God, Mormons believe that God is elevated matter. In other words, he's just a man like me or you. He just, like, has superpowers and he's elevated. So it's basically kind of like a materialistic worldview. But again, I want to ask about that. Maybe I have a misunderstanding, misconception, and definitely deprives God of the eminence and transcendence that we read in the Bible and is philosophically accurate. So that's the really interesting, is that Mormons have to argue against, with atheists, things like the cosmological proof and the ontological proof, because they prove things about God and God's nature, that he's immaterial and extra mundane and divinely simple, things that Mormons can't agree with, which I think is funny. All right, so let me just wrap this up, and then I will check. I'll read you guys' super chats, see what you guys are saying in the chat here. So let me just, again, summarize what I'm saying here about Christology, study of Jesus Christ. Again, why is this important? So we know that the church thought about these things. Our faith is not irrational. The church thought very deeply about who is Christ, when you came incarnate, the Word of God, second person of the Trinity, became incarnate. It's two natures, divine nature, human nature. Divine nature, it shares equally with God the Father. They are distinct natures. He's fully human, fully divine, and again, they're distinct. They're not dissolved. It's not that Jesus just has a divine mind or anything like that. He has two wills: the divine will and the human will, and of course the divine will is perfectly in line with God the Father's will, which explains, again, in the scriptures, when you read when Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane, he says, Father, if it be thy will, take this cup from me, or let this cup to pass from me, or something to that effect. And people are like, well, isn't Jesus God, so wouldn't he know already God's will? Yeah, he knows it, but it's the human will. He has that human will that doesn't want to die, but the divine will, which is, of course, in fully in communion with God's will, they share that will together. That's what it means to be the Trinity, to share with, through, like, a common will. The Christ had to die. And that's the position at Chalcedon and the position we have to take. Okay. But it's interesting is that some Calvinists are, I believe, in what's called, like, the social view of the Trinity, in which, like, God has three centers of consciousness, so he has three different wills, which is I believe that it could definitely be considered heretical, but it's definitely not the Catholic view, that's for sure. All right, so thank you guys for listening. I'm just gonna end the recording here. Maybe we'll start it up again if we're talking about something interesting, but I think I'll end it here. So that's a lesson on Christology, as well as, again, let me just remind you guys that when you receive Holy Communion on Christmas Eve or Christmas Day, think about the manger. Think about that Christ, King of the universe, or the rightful King of the universe, placed in a manger, placed in a place where, like, animals eat out of it, dirty, disgusting. It's like our souls. Christ is coming down into our souls to be the King of our lives, that he makes our souls his throne room, just as he made the manger his throne. All right, think about that analogy, reflect on it, meditate on it. That's my challenge to you guys as we approach Christmas. All right. So thank you for watching. I'll see you in the next video.